Now he is a Dominican priest and an associate professor of molecular microbiology and genetics at Providence College. His intellectual interests range from molecular and cellular genetics to morphology. He is a world-renowned speaker on the topic of genetic synthesis. His talk today is entitled, What Does Human Genomics Tell Us About Adam and Eve from a Catholic Perspective? Please join me in welcoming Father Nicanor Austriaco.
It's an incredible pleasure, and I'm grateful to God for the opportunity to return to MIT 17 years after I finished my PhD here. And I, too, was a member of the Tech Catholic community, and I remember coming to these lectures with Victor. Victor and I were both here many years ago. So and to come back here as a Dominican priest was something I certainly didn't expect when I graduated and, from here. In 96. I mean, though the experience that I had while a student here and while a member of the Tech Catholic community was actually instrumental in my discernment for such that a year or so after I graduated, I would enter the novitiate and would be ordained to the Holy Priesthood about 8 years later. So when I was ordained to the priesthood, my Dominican superiors sent me to Providence College. Providence College is the only Dominican institution of higher learning in the United States. And so they said, look, you have a PhD in biology from MIT. Why don't you go and do something with it? So I had a great joy. I have been there now for 9.5 years. I got tenure there. I run the laboratory there. And it's cool because one of my students is here. He's doing his PhD now here. You get to see how it all comes back. So I'm here today to talk to you about Adam and Eve. It's one of those hot theological questions. You know, how are we going to talk about Adam and Eve with regards to the accounts in Genesis? And what I'd like to propose to you today is that theology, like molecular biology, and like many of the other sciences, is about model building. And for those of you who are doing your studies in the sciences or engineering, it's all about models. Theology is the same thing. So what I'd like to demonstrate to you today is how you actually go about doing that. How do you go about building a theological model? Because at the end of the day, what I'm going to propose to you is a way to try to take disparate pieces of information, data, both scientific data, and because I'm speaking as a Catholic theologian, theological data as well. And you're going to put the data together into a model. And as anyone who's built models of one sort or the other, they're tentative. Now over time, as the evidence builds, the model becomes more and more probable. And eventually what you hope to do is you basically try to take all those rival models of all those other labs and all those other institutions around the planet and you basically destroy them. And in theology, you're working with a larger data set. Because in theology, you're working with a data set that has accumulated over the last 2,000 years. You know, one of the things about biology is that when my students do biology today, we rarely go back more than 10 years to look at a scientific paper. And yet, as a theologian, you have to look at data that's 2,000 years old, and you also have to look at how that data has been read and interpreted in and within a tradition. And so what I hope to do today is to illustrate how you actually do that as a Catholic. And I need to stress that because different Christian traditions have different parameters for model building. And so I'm going to illustrate how a Catholic Christian, a Catholic theologian, will attempt to reconcile and make and develop a model to bring some coherence into what appears to be disparate areas of human knowledge. In this case, molecular biology, paleogenomics, as well as theology, the revelation of Jesus Christ. So this started a couple of years ago, actually, with a publication of a special issue of Perspectives on Science and Christian Faith. It's the American Scientific Affiliation, the group of Christians, primarily of the evangelical stripe, who come together. They're scientists from different backgrounds who are coming together to struggle with the dialogue between faith and reason, between science and revealed truth. And someone brought this special issue to my attention. I don't know, it's reading Genesis, the historicity of Adam and Eve, genomics and evolutionary science. And I've since been involved in Templeton-funded work to try to reconcile a Christian theological account of the origins of Homo sapiens along with the science, the best science that we have today. And one of the reasons why this is a very pressing topic is that very many young Christians who are working in science feel that they have to choose between science and their faith. And if they're confronted with that choice, a significant number of them will choose the science over the faith. And so many of my Protestant and evangelical friends are trying to figure out how to bring this together. How can we help young Christians who are struggling with this apparent tension between faith and reason? How can we help them to reconcile the two? So I'm going to be speaking as a Catholic. I was speaking at a college last week in Virginia. And one of the questions that came up was, why bother? Okay? So why bother? I know many friends here at MIT, when I was here, who would say, science and religion are two distinct areas of knowledge. And Stephen Jay Gould of evolutionary fame, the late Stephen Jay Gould would talk about how you would have to keep these two magisterial areas of knowledge separate. But you see, I'm a Catholic. And because I'm a Catholic, one of the things is that within the Catholic tradition, there is a presupposition that both faith and reason lead us to God. That's a given. And it's a given because from within the Catholic tradition, there's a clear understanding that reason is also a gift from God. And so if revelation is a gift from God, and reason is a gift from God, then both of them inevitably lead back to Him. This is the opening sentence of now St. John Paul II's famous encyclical, Fides and Ratio, Faith and Reason, published in 1998. The first line goes like this: faith and reason are like two wings on which the human spirit rises to the contemplation of truth. And so both of them are important. Now the ramifications for this theologically, because a Catholic would say that without faith, one of your wings is clipped. And that, of course, is a completely different theological discussion. But we're going to take it for granted, because I'm speaking from within the Catholic tradition, that both of these, faith and reason, are absolutely important for coming to know God. Now, because of that, there's another assumption within the Catholic tradition, and it is this. There cannot be a conflict between authentic theology and authentic science. There just can't. That's an assumption. That's a premise. And it can be argued to from theological claims about how all of creation is actually creation. And so because everything is creation, you can't have any inherent conflict in creation, because creation is the product, the fruit of a coherent mind, a divine mind. And since the divine mind is coherent and intelligible, everything has to somehow come together. Now, it may not be clear from the get-go how it comes together. And part of the struggle as a theologian, as a believer, is to try, and sometimes it will take a lifetime and then some, to struggle with this apparent tension between the two. But the assumption within the Catholic Christian tradition is that if you work hard enough and you work long enough, you will eventually be able to resolve any apparent contradictions between faith and reason. So that's what I hope to begin to do today. So this talk is going to be divided into three separate parts. because we're going to be accumulating the data points that we need to build our model. So the first, I need to go over the science, and I need to talk about what human genomic science tells us about the origins of our species. That's the science. Then I'm going to move to the theology, and the theology is going to focus primarily at this point on where the Catholic Church stands today with regards to her self-understanding on the revelation of Jesus Christ about the origins of our species. And then I'm going to propose a model, one possible way to reconcile. Now, as you know, models don't necessarily have to be true, but they have to be tested. And theologically, we do this by simply arguing and testing them by putting them across, by asking them, challenging them, interrogating them with harder and harder questions to see if the explanatory power of that model will exceed any rival accounts that could be provided in its stead. So we're going to go through these three particular things. I'm going to start off with the science. I'm not sure how many of you are Core 7. How many of you are Core 7? All right, they're very, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to have to go down to the basics. I'm going to assume high school biology, right? And so I'm going to go high school biology, and I'm going to build up and to try and illustrate what contemporary biology, how biologists understand today the origins of our species. So to do that, I need to begin with a basic slide that I use in my own intro, freshman intro bio class. I'm giving an exam on Wednesday. And you're talking about the genome, and the genome, first of all, is all of the genetic information of a particular organism. And if you go online and you Google sequence genomes, there are lots out there right now, especially microbial genomes, genomes of unicellular microscopic organisms. Now, if you take the genome can be divided into two compartments. The primary one is the nuclear genome, and if you ever hear about chromosomes, this is the nuclear genome. But we can't forget, and I need to tell you about, a small genome called the mitochondrial genome. And from high school biology, you may or may not remember that the mitochondria is that part of the cell, the organelle, the small part of the cell, that's involved in generating energy for the cell. And this little factory, energy factory, has its own genome. And there are historical reasons why it has its own genome. But for now, we're going to focus in on that nuclear genome. And that nuclear genome for us consists of chromosomes. And there are 20, we have 23 pairs of chromosomes. You know, you have chromosome 1, so right here is chromosome 1 to 23. You have two, because one you got from your mother, the other one you got from your father. And so there are pairs, and each one of these chromosomes can be painted. This is called chromosome painting. I'm pretty sure they do chromosome painting here at the Institute. And what you can do is you can identify each chromosome by the particular painting pattern you get under the microscope. And so here you've got in the cell, and these are all the chromosomes of a typical human cell. This is a large electron micrograph of one of those chromosomes, actually a replicated chromosome during the cell cycle. Now if I take that chromosome, what you will see is that chromosome is actually a single linear molecule of DNA. And hopefully, even if you're not Core 7, you've heard about DNA, especially here. So what happens if you take this DNA and you stretch it out, you get the famous double helix. And you know, as I tell my students, a typical, if you take all your chromosomes and stretch them out end to end, they're about this long. And now one of your cells is smaller than the period at the end of a sentence times Roman 12. And part of the challenge of this cell is to take that incredibly long piece of spaghetti and compress it and organize it so that it can be within the nucleus of the cell and still that spaghetti is organized. If you remember how you eat spaghetti, if you're not careful, it gets all over you. And if you're trying to look for a particular part of that spaghetti, it's incredibly hard to do. And yet the cell has to do that. Because the cell has this huge bowl of spaghetti in its nucleus, And yet it has to be able to identify particular genes, turn them on, turn them off, and do it in a way that's rapidly enough, that's rapid enough so that you respond to things that will attempt to kill you. So if you take this DNA and you stretch it out, one of the things you will see is that DNA is actually a string of information, right? So this is actually the gene that, one of the genes that my own laboratory back at Providence College is studying. We named this gene, and it's yeast vax inhibitor. But this is the gene, starts with this ATG, it ends with this TAA. If you were in course 7, you'd go, that's the capital letter, and that's the full stop that defines this gene as a sentence. But the thing that you should take home with you is it's made up of four letters, G, A, T, C, and each of those letters stands for a particular molecule. And so at the end of the day, your piece of DNA is just one long string of four molecules in a particular pattern. And your genome is made up of 300 billion of these letters, and these letters are called bases. So what you can do is that biologists, what we do is we can compare and contrast genomes in order to determine the relationships among these genomes. And so consider this, right? If you take, we're approaching the end of the semester, if you take 10 final exams, if I as a professor receive 10 final exams and they have similar answers, it can tell you something about the relationships among those exams. And in fact, what does it tell you? It tells you that they have a common origin. We call that cheating, okay? So if the genomes are similar, we simply posit a common origin for them, right? And again, you can take genes, so this is a particular gene, I'm not going to go into which gene, and this is the genes. There's humans, chimps, rats, guinea pigs, cows, and dogs, and you can see that when you compare the genes, there are similarities and differences among them. So take this very first position. So in this very first position, you have A, 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 but there's a G in the rat gene of that position. So we can compare different sequences. Imagine again the 10 exams, and you can figure out who's more closely related to whom. So the more similar your sequences are, the assumption is that these two sequences are more similar because they have a more recent origin than two sequences that are more divergent. And so I have no time to defend that. Technically, I'm just going to tell you, we assume that similar genomes have a common historical origin. So here, you have a very common gene called tubulin, and you can see there's an alpha tubulin in human, fly, worm, and yeast, and then there's a beta tubulin. These are actually, they're very, very similar. It's 40% identity between an alpha and a beta tubulin. But what happens is, we then surmise that these tubulins, and of course we are presupposing an evolutionary context here, these tubulins are similar because they are derived from an ancestral tubulin gazillion years ago. And that the more recent ones, so alpha tubulin in humans and flies, they're more similar in sequence because they actually have a more recent common ancestor. And so we can do this with genomes. We do this with manuscript texts. So anyone who's looking at historical texts are able to trace the provenance of different texts by comparing and contrasting scribal errors. This is basically what we're doing. So there's a genetic principle here. More closely related genomes have a more recent common ancestor. And then the differences between the genomes can be used to estimate the historical time since their divergence. Now, there are many presuppositions here about the rate of change. You have a molecular clock that we actually have to standardize and normalize. But that's a problem that biologists are still grappling with today. How accurate is that clock? So this is how we understand our evolutionary lineage. This is the hominid lineage. Here we are, humans. And based on comparing and contrasting the different genomes that we have available, we know that we are more closely related to chimps than we are with gorillas. And chimps and humans, there's a 6 million, so we had a common ancestor about 6 million years ago, and then gorillas and the common ancestors between chimpanzees and humans 10 million years ago. And so we can reconstruct this historical tree based on comparing and contrasting human genomes. Now, if you take that branch and you blow it up, what you will discover is here again, here we are. We can relate ourselves to two extinct human-like species, hominins. Neanderthals, extinct about 25,000 years ago, despite claims that you can see them in New York. Right? And then the Denisovans, again, the only extant sample of Denisovans is actually a small little piece of bone, but from that piece of bone, a savante Pago and his students were able to extract DNA and sequence that entire genome. So we don't even know what they look like, but we know what their genes look like. And so you have this, and then finally what happens is if you take modern humans and you break it up even more, it turns out that if you compare our lineages, Europeans, Caucasians, Asians, and Melanesians, these are the original inhabitants of Polynesia and the Southern Pacific, are more closely related to each other than to our brothers and sisters who are descended from the African lineage. So this is, and the common thought is to be 65,000 years ago. Now, how do we know that? Okay, how do we know that all of us have a common ancestry? So what we do is, and this has been done by National Genographic, so the National Geographic has a National Geographic program. What you do is people from all over the world have been contributing basically their genomes, and they're just sequencing and comparing them. And what you can do is you can take the genomes of people today, those from an African lineage, for example, Archbishop Desmond Tutu's DNA was actually sequenced, and you have the European. So you can just get all sorts of people, usually very rich people, who have their DNA sequenced. Now it's actually striking because at this point in time, you know, that the standard goal for molecular biology is to have a $1,000 genome. So in other words, we would want to have the ability to sequence your genome to an equivalent cost for you having an MRI. And since having an MRI seems to be something we do regularly, the hope is that eventually that sequencing your genome will be something that we will do routinely as a matter of fact. Now this raises an enormous number of ethical questions, an enormous amount. And I work as a bioethicist, and there are difficulties here because your genome is not just simply yours. You know, when I talk with you, I tell you, it's just not your genome. Your genome belongs to your family. If I find out you have something, it's likely that other members of your family also are carrying a certain mutation. So when someone says, well, I want to have my genome sequenced and I don't care what anyone else says, I say, wait a minute. If you get your genome sequenced and you discover you're carrying a certain mutation that predisposes you to a particular incurable condition, it's not just you who's being affected. Your entire lineage, everyone who comes after you, everyone, all your nieces, nephews, everyone is brought into that conversation because we share our genomes. So the idea here is that we can then go ahead and sequence these genomes and we can figure out what's unique about them. So the Africans have a red mutation, a blue mutation, and a green mutation. Mutations don't have color, but this is just a point, right? And so we can reconstruct, and what we have done is we have reconstructed the appearance of these mutations over time. And so we can say, well, if these share a common mutation, then their ancestor must have had that mutation. And you can reconstruct one of these phylogenetic trees, and you discover that all of us are related. All of us are descended from a common population. So if you compare the modern human genomes, it supports what is called the out of Africa model, the out of Africa hypothesis, where our species evolves somewhere in Africa, somewhat, some say Eastern Africa, some say Southern Africa, that's disputed. But the general agreement is that we evolved and appeared as a species in Africa, and then we all went out of Africa, and every human population everywhere else is actually descended from this progenitor population in Africa. So there was a consensus. This is a wonderful issue of the journal Nature. There's a consensus that we have a common origin 120 to 65,000 years ago. We don't have that precision yet. And then we disperse from Africa about 65,000 years ago. And this is always disputed. The dates are plus or minus is anything, plus or minus some statistical deviation of years. Now, to give you an example, so this is my Y chromosome. I happen to be sitting in dinner, at dinner at one of these events, and the person next to me was like, "Do you want to have your genome studied?" And I'm like, "Sure." So, so I sent my cells in, and they were able, this is the Y chromosome. Now, one of the things about the Y chromosome is a male has it, because it's what defines maleness in our species. And by definition, you only inherit it from your father. And so the Y chromosome is actually a historical record of your patriarchal lineage. And so what happens is they can go through and they can identify markers on particular male's Y chromosome. I believe they're having a Christmas special now. I think it's down to like $60. And what you do is then you can go ahead, and this is actually my data. So by looking at my Y chromosome and the genetic mutations in my Y chromosome, we can identify the, in a sense, the history of my patriarchal lineage. And we can say that, you know, started off somewhere in Africa, and I carry these different mutations in my Y chromosome, and we can figure out when those mutations first appeared. So we can know I had to be, well, not my ancestors had to be here in order to acquire that mutation so that they would then be able to give that mutation to me. Now, because mutations happen not in historical time, as in thousands of years, but tens of thousands of years, basically we are able to only localize my ancestors to East Africa, Eastern China. But you know, if you look at Guns, Germs, and Steel, a very famous book by a geographer, what you will see is that he has this incredible picture of the population of basically the Philippine Islands 5,000 years ago and Polynesia. And so we can then, you know, the genetics says that my ancestors were out here in South China, Eastern China, which makes sense because I'm a Filipino. And what happens is through migration of the population, you actually get to the Philippines 5,000 years ago. So you see, you in your DNA, you carry the history of your family. And the idea here is that as a species, all the human beings today carry the history of our entire species. That's basically what paleogenomics is looking at, and trying to reconstruct that history based not on going back into history, but looking at the DNA of the human beings that are extant today. Now, I mentioned to you mitochondria. And one thing that you may or may not know, if the Y chromosome is inherited by a man only from his father, the mitochondria is inherited only from your mother. So men and women inherit their mitochondria only from their mother. So we can actually look at this mitochondria, and we can trace the maternal lineage of both men and women. And this has been done, and it turns out that all the human beings today, every single human being today, has mitochondrial DNA that is derived from a single female. So we're all related. It's a long time ago, but we're all related, right? Now, when I tell people this, and biologists call this individual mitochondrial Eve, hopefully for obvious reasons. Right? One of the things people goes, oh my God, this is Genesis. Now, I point out, and this is the data, basically we're descended from a single female, and again the numbers, 200,000, 150,000, there's always disputes. Scientists always argue. We never really stop arguing, we just get over it. Right? And basically what happens is you're able to trace this. And we're descended from a single female, but it's really important that I need to point out that this does not prove she was the only woman alive at the time. okay? And so you go, here she is, and this is her, you know, that's her mate. Now you notice, this is us, and all of us are descended from that female. But it doesn't mean that she wasn't alone. All it means is that given enough amount of time, and given random genetic drift over time, there's always going to be fixation of a particular allele, a particular copy, a particular version of a gene. And that's like modern genetics. So what happens is, that is not true, there was only one woman, right? Now if you also look at the Y chromosomes, it turns out that all of the Y chromosomes, so all the males in this room, all the males on this planet, are also descended from a single male if you look at our Y chromosomes. Now it's not quite clear if they knew each other. We do not have that precision in biology. And for a while, they were living in different moments in time. There was a paper published in the last 6 months that had basically brought them to within the same period of years. So there's actually a possibility that they overlap. Now, let me illustrate a proposal to you. This is a pedigree, right? Here they are, here are all the beagles, and here is daddy beagle and mommy beagle. Now, this is where you use your reason. Does this make sense? Yes. What happens if I do this? And I go, here's a Dalmatian. Does this make sense? You're like, no, it doesn't make sense. You have to then conclude that the presence of these three dogs, two of which are beagles and one is the Dalmatian, necessarily means there were at least two pairs of dogs, a beagle pair and a Dalmatian pair, in history. So what biologists have done is we ask, given the genetic diversity of people today, how many mating pairs, approximately 65,000 years ago, would you need to posit, to explain the beagles and the Dalmatians who are actually at MIT? You see, so that's the kind of thinking the biologists do. And we get it down to it's about 1,000 to 2,000 mating pairs. That's a lot smaller than most people imagine, right? And they're living in a small geographic area around 100,000 years ago. Now, a thing you may or may not know is that there are also inbreeding within the human family. So here you are, these are Neanderthals and Denisovans, and I mentioned to you these are now extinct hominin species, human-like species. It turns out that if you are not of African descent, approximately 4% of your genome is Neanderthal genome, is Neanderthal DNA. And we know that there is interbreeding between the Neanderthals and the groups of people that would give rise to the Europeans, the Chinese, and the Melanesians. And not surprisingly, or maybe surprisingly, if you don't think about it, most of these genes that we have inherited from the Neanderthals are involved in the immune system and how we protect ourselves against pathogens, you see? So the idea is that these Neanderthals were evolved to deal with pathogens, and as we left Africa, we encountered pathogens that they had encountered before that we had not. And now we don't think that this was like, you know, regular breeding. And we can calculate the probability. This is like smashing graph. So it's rare interbreeding, but we know that they were able to breed, which raises questions in biology. If you have Neanderthals and Homo sapiens able to breed and to reproduce, are we or are we not of the same species? This is a species question, and that's a philosophy of biology question. But same thing with Denisovans. So if you are from Polynesia, you have some Denisovan DNA in your DNA in addition to the Neanderthal DNA that you have. Now, one of the things that I need to point out is this. What are we looking for, right? What are we looking for the evolutionary appearance of the human species? Now, notice, as a biologist, I will say, well, we're looking for the human form. We're looking for, and if you were a paleontologist, you would compare skulls, you would compare limbs, you would be looking for similarities and differences between Neanderthals and Homo sapiens. Now I have to do a little bit of philosophy here, because I would like to point out to you that what makes us distinctive is that we have language. Now, there's a whole other debate as to about what constitutes language, whether or not non-human species are able to have language. I was on a train coming back from New York, and I was overhearing a group of ladies behind me who were very excited because they were reading a book about how crows are more intelligent than people, and how crows have language. And they were really excited. I was resisting the temptation to turn around and say, when was the last time you had a conversation with a crow? Right? But there's a lot of confusion about what constitutes the cognitive structure specific for our species. I'm just going to take it for granted now that it's language, the kind of language, the semantics and the syntax together that distinguish our forms of communication from the other forms of communication that are out there. Now, there are actually papers, so this is a really cool paper published in Nature Reviews about human brain evolution, and neurocognitive sciences have asked, how many mutations would you need to explain the evolution of human cognition and language? And they posit about 10. And of course, this is all models yet, right? So there are 10. So if you notice, there's the Denisovians, the Neanderthals, there's us. And what they posit is that there is a difference between these other hominins and our species because of the appearance of 10 unique mutations that reconfigure our brain structure, so our brain structure is able to do what we can do. Now, in the paleontologists, there is a debate between what are called anatomically and behaviorally modern humans. So if you look at anatomically modern humans, you can find skulls and bones that look like ours, and they go all the way back 200,000 years ago. But here's the thing. There appears to be a large gap between the appearance of anatomically modern humans and the appearance of behaviorally modern humans. We're talking here about painting, jewelry. So you have like 100,000 years where it looks like creatures that look like us just simply didn't behave like us. And in fact, there's a debate. Why is there a 100,000 year gap between the appearance of creatures that look like us and the appearance in evolutionary history of creatures that not only look like us, but appear to have the kind of cognitive structures? And in fact, and this is, it's actually this paleontological difference that motivates the molecular biologists to posit that we can look the same, but our brains are probably different. And it's the changes in the brain structure and the brain architecture that allows us to be what we associate with our species. All right, that's a science. So now we're going to go to theology. So you're gonna hold that, that's the data that we're gonna keep from the molecular biology, and now we're gonna go to theology. And we're going to go to Catholic theology in particular. And what I need to focus in on here right now is I'm going to try to summarize 2,000 years of reflection in a few slides on what we are as human beings and the significance of that, especially in light of the revelation of Jesus Christ. Okay, so we're going to... So now when I talk to people about this, and if you know anything about this question within the Catholic theological tradition, you're going to bring up an encyclical, a papal encyclical called Humani Generis. So just like you had Fides and Ratio in 1998, you have Humani Generis in 1950. And Humani Generis is a papal encyclical. In a sense, it's a white paper that summarizes in an authoritative way the current state of theological thinking within the Catholic community. And the Pope, this is an article of Catholic faith, the Pope has a charism, a gift from God, that allows him to articulate for the Catholic people what we believe. And so you have a document here like this, Humani Generis, Pope Pius XII, And this is a very famous line. For the faithful cannot embrace that opinion which maintains that either after Adam there existed on this earth true men who did not take their origin through natural generation from him as from the first parent of all, or that Adam represents a certain number of first parents. Now this is in theological circles, this is called the two theories, monogenism and polygenism. One couple, Adam and Eve, or many couples. Adam, Eve, Steve, Mary, blah, blah, blah. Okay? So, and in 1950, the Pope is saying that the faithful cannot embrace. If you look at the statement, it appears like he's saying, look, the many couples can't do that. We've got to stick with the one couple. Now, the reason, now, when I have people who tell me this, I say, but did you read the next line? Why can't we do that? He says, it is no way apparent how such an opinion can be reconciled with what the sources of a real truth, the gospel, and the documents of the teaching of our proposed with regard to original sin. So notice what the Pope is saying. He's saying, look, we have two models, two theories, two hypotheses. One couple, many couples. Right now, we can't see how you can reconcile this theory of many couples with the data of theology, the data of the gospel. Now, we do this all the time in the sciences. You go, my students will come out, wait a minute. You're proposing this model, but there's all this data that your model is not going to be able to explain. So you go back and you try to figure out how your model will explain all the data, right? Now, the thing you need to know about this history is that this is always a snapshot in time. It is always a reflection of human knowledge at a given point in time. And this is what human knowledge was like in 1950 regarding human evolution. So this is us, and I just told you that. This is what we biologists thought in 1950. Biologists thought in 1950 that Asians, Africans, and Europeans were independent human populations that evolved independently from a non-human, pre-human creature called Homo erectus, and there was random interbreeding all over back and forth. I'm telling you today that because of paleogenomic sciences, we now have this account where we know that Asians, Africans, and Europeans are actually descended from a common species, Homo sapiens, that appeared in Africa about 50,000 years ago, then there was an out of Africa migration. Why does it matter to a Catholic Christian? Because of Jesus Christ. Okay? Now, I'm going to switch theology. For a Catholic Christian, for every Christian, Jesus Christ is at the center, he should be at the center of all we are, all that we do, and all that we think. Now, the only reason why? Because Christians believe he is the Savior. Now, one of the things that you have to understand theologically is you go, well, how did he save? Right? And theologians have been reflecting upon this question. They said, he saved in many ways. One way he saved is by his act of obedience that led to the events of Good Friday and the resurrection on Easter Sunday. But another way that he saved us is he assumed our human nature, our fallen human nature, and in that assuming of fallen human nature and uniting that human nature to divine nature, he was able to redeem that nature and, in fact, raise that nature above the angels. Now, notice, if Jesus Christ redeemed your nature by assuming that nature, your nature and his nature must be the same nature. Because theologically, it would cause problems if the nature of someone who lived in China is different from the nature of someone who lived in the States. And the same, because it would separate your nature from the salvific act of Jesus Christ assuming that nature. This is a theological claim. This is a theological data point that needs to be addressed. In this scheme, it was very difficult and not impossible to imagine that. Because you see, Jesus was in Asia, right? If the Europeans and those who lived in France were had a nature that evolved completely from Homo erectus, his nature here would be very different from that nature there. It would be very hard to explain theologically how he could save our nature. That's what the Pope was saying in 1950. It's really hard to explain that. But you see, now, one of the things that this account allows us to do is it allows us to say that since all of us are descended from the same genetic pool, we actually have the same nature. And so the same nature that was assumed, assumed by Christ, is the same nature. Now this, of course, is something that only Christians worry about. Just like biologists worry about certain things that mechanical engineers don't even care about. And if you're dealing with an interdisciplinary project, you know how that works. Because they're worried about this, and the other group goes, I don't even know why you're worried about that. Each tradition, each community has their own particular concerns, and we're trying to put them all together. That's what this is about. So now what happens, is not surprisingly, in 96, as the science continues to evolve, the church also begins to start to say, look, how are we going to reconcile that? So you have John Paul II in 1996. He basically says that the recognition of evolution is more than a hypothesis, right? You go to 2004, Joseph Cardinal Ratzinger, now the Pope Emeritus, Benedict XVI, he will say in paragraph 63, you notice, when they're discussing the origin of the human species, they will actually say, in a humanoid population of common genetic lineage. So in 1950, for theological reasons, the church was hesitant to embrace a particular biological account of human origins. You can see in 2004, and then again in 2004, whether as individuals or in population, the idea of a population, rather than as an individual, as anchoring human nature, becomes a viable option because the apparent tension between the theological data and the scientific data was beginning to be resolvable in the minds of those. So finally, in the last few minutes, how do you put it together? Right? So how do you put it together? People would say, all right, before we attempt to put it together, how trustworthy is the science? Because heck, you know, Phlogiston, which is the you don't know about it, but it used to be the coolest element that was out there and is now non-existent, right? How certain are we? Science is, of course, always tending. Now, people will say, well, science never comes up with truth. I go, wait a minute. DNA is a double helix. All right? Now, there may be exceptions to the rule. It may be left-handed in some occasions that we get cDNA. It's like in the opposite direction. But we don't say that somewhere down the road DNA is going to be discovered to be a triple helix. There's so much information to support the explanatory power for DNA being a double helix that we know it is a double helix. It is a fact. And one of the things I point out to people when I go out to parishes is evolutionary theory is to modern biology as the doctrine of the Trinity is to Christianity. It is the organizing principle for everything biologists do. So when someone comes to me and says, well, you know, is evolution a fact? I say, the rival theories to explain the origins of the diversity of life simply fail to explain this enormous amount of data that evolutionary theory can explain. It explains why my students can take a gene from humans, put it into simple baking yeast, Fleischmann, which you can buy, you know, in the local grocery, we can take a human gene, put it into a yeast cell, and it will work. Not only will it will work pretty much like the human does, so that we take yeast, or we can, my students study cell death, we can kill yeast over and over and over and over again, and it leads us to give us some insight into human cell death. You see? And so to explain that, you have to explain the similarities and the differences, and evolutionary theory does that, which is why I would say, well, is it true? I say, well, its explanatory power is so vast that the likelihood that an alternative account is true is minuscule. Right? And that's, I think, the best way you can talk about that. And how do we do this? Because, well, evidence mouths and evidence from different labs doing different techniques coming to the same conclusion, which is why when a biologist is doing experiments, you want to do as many different techniques and protocols, and if they all lead you to the same conclusion, you are more likely to believe that than using one protocol and one under one set of conditions. So you try to approach it in many different ways. It becomes increasingly unlikely that rival hypotheses are true. That's the way a biologist accounts for evolution. It is incredibly unlikely that rival hypotheses, this does not mean that evolutionary theory, as we understand it now, will not itself evolve. Just like DNA is a double helix, we know there are exceptions, we know there are things about the diversity and the mechanisms for the evolution of life that we still don't understand. But the general framework, the big picture, is unlikely to be undermined at this point. So what we're going to do now, if you notice, it's about original sin. We have to figure out a way how there's a common human nature such that the nature that Jesus assumes and the nature of every single human being that needs to be redeemed is held in common. And so here is a possible model, right? So what you do is you have 150,000, you have a small population of archaic humans. Within that population, some of them are going to acquire the mutations that will alter their cognitive structure that allows them, at that point in time, to acquire the capacity to have language. And then, now, we don't go into the philosophy, you have a spiritual soul. Soul is not a theological category, it's a philosophical category. My yeast cells have souls. Bananas have souls, so do coconuts. Now, and that's what people go, what? All right? But it's a philosophical category, not a theological one, and it's a philosophical category that explains the origin, the causal origin of the powers of that particular organism. Now, because of what we can do, philosophers from before Christ, Aristotle in particular, posit the existence of an immaterial principle to explain. You know, the dog has a soul, but it doesn't look like its soul is immaterial. It has a material soul. But the arguments have been made, and of course they've been disputed over and over again, that we are able to do certain things that are profoundly unique because we are able to deal with abstraction. And that abstract concept, right, beauty, justice, truth, that these concepts in some way can't be reduced to images. And if that's not the case, it has to deal with an immaterial concept. So the idea is that a group of them, small population, we don't need to know how many, it's very small, because of the way that biologists understand mutations coming together, particular individuals within the population. Adam and Eve are members of this population, right? They disobey the Lord, they have a fall. Now, it's really interesting because people go, how do you know there was a historical fall? How do you know that human beings messed up? Now, this is a theological argument. Because, you see, from a theological perspective, we say God is good. If God is good, he's got to make good things. Because that's what good people do. They make good things, by definition. And if you look around, things are not so good. And more importantly, if you look within yourself, things are not so good. You know, I'm a priest, and my students would say, are you a priest, a scientist, a theologian? I go, I'm a priest first. And I've had the great privilege of speaking to many, many students about so many things, the affairs of the heart. And one of the things you discover is that we often don't do the things that we want to do. And we often do things that we know in the long run will hurt us. Why is that? Why are we broken? And so the theological account of the fall attempts to reconcile how a good creator God would create good things, and yet today they're broken. And so that is a theological explanation for why that's the case. And then, of course, in time, you would have the Savior. So I'm going to, the acknowledgments, the end. So first of all, this is my honors colloquium. So I teach science and religion every spring at Providence College. And it was actually in the spring of 2012 where this group of students said, well, Father, what can we say about Adam and Eve? And that's when I first started thinking about this and the challenge. This is Father Hyacinth Marie Cordell. He is a Dominican priest. He is associate pastor at St. Pius V Parish. And when he entered the Dominican order, he didn't believe in evolution. So we argued. We argued for 8 years. Oh, it was, and now? And I was trying to explain, you know? There are cultural reasons why there are people who find evolutionary theory difficult. There's cultural reasons. 8 years of arguing, and he's agreed that evolution is a true account. He agrees it's reconcilable with an account of Christianity that he could live with. He pushed me. No, that's not true. And so you're trying to figure out the best way to explain to a non-molecular biologist, but someone who is a believer, trying very hard to try, because you see, his experience when he was in college, that evolutionary theory was used to beat him up for his faith. And so he had developed an allergy against evolutionary theory. And so it was my privilege to speak to him and show him how it's not necessarily in tension with what he thought he believed. And then this is the most recent picture of my lab. I was on sabbatical last year. This is my own laboratory. This is the Dead Gay Society, and these are our two mascots. Long story. And it's been a great, to be a Dominican priest and a scientist at Providence College has been a great blessing, because I've been able to do, you know, real science and just have a great time doing that. And then, you know, very few places, even at MIT, when I was at MIT, you know, science all the way. And when I entered the order, I had to get another bachelor's degree in philosophy and then another master's degree in theology, and now I'm finishing up another doctorate in theology. We're geeks for God. Now, the thing is, one of the great things about Providence College, it has a Western Civ program. So you'd be sitting there running a jail and doing restriction enzyme digest and discussing the brothers Karamazov with one of your undergrads and the human impact of that. And everyone is required to do that, right? And here, I remember being a student here and I took a religion class in course 21. I was down here, and it was the first time I'd ever taken religion it was so frustrating because, and in fact, it's actually instrumental, because I took this class and but the professor was so dismissive of religion. And he was so dismissive of the New Testament, the Old Testament, and it forced me to actually begin to think about this. And I ended up meeting the Catholic Fellowship at MIT. And on Friday night, we go to Building 10, not 10, what is the one at the end? One. Building 1, we would go there and we'd, every Friday night, you know, and my lab would go off to the bar and I would go to Building 1. And I had a group of 40, 45 Catholic students, undergrads and grads. We argued about everything, We read everything. We argued about everything. And it was also an opportunity for me. They had me start doing a thing called adoration. I didn't know what that was at the time. It was an E20, what is the religious?
W11.
It's been a while. And I would go there and I would begin to pray. And it was that, it was beginning to pray, and to begin to pray, to argue the faith, to see that faith and reason came together, that actually allowed me to discover my vocation. So now I've got to end with my grants. These are the grants that support my research as a molecular biologist. And then I work with the BioLogos Foundation to bring together faith and reason from an evolutionary perspective. And I have a grant from them to do that. Thank you very much for your kind attention. That's the current calculation.
A human that looks human is not quite us, the one that actually has language.
So it would be, that the hypothesis is that you evolved a creature that looks like us, but you needed additional rewiring of the neural system in order to facilitate the kind of behavior that we have.
Okay, so my question is, to go in one step of evolution, of going from one generation to the next to have 10 mutations, that's very unlikely.
Right. So the thing I imagine, so if you look at hunter-gatherer societies today, so the model for the kind of behavior that we would see amongst these very early humans would be something analogous to the hunter-gatherer communities that we have in very rural parts of the planet today. And what you see often is that you have a small tribe, and then mates, you actually leave your tribe to go out to mate. So I can imagine a situation where you have populations where you have, let's say, 5 mutations rising in that population, 5 mutations that arise in the other one, and then you have a mating between individuals who are carrying these 5, and you actually have progeny, children that now have a combination of the 10 mutations that their individual parents actually carry separately. See, so it's not just that mutations that are arising in individuals, you also have in matings. So you have to see whether there's interbreeding between different populations, and this interbreeding facilitates fixation of the mutation within a population. And the idea is that this combination mutation would be so advantageous. So once you have human language, it would be so advantageous that this population of speaking bipeds versus that population of non-speaking bipeds, this population would be much more, there would be strong evolutionary pressure for this group to outcompete the others. And so it would spread out. Now, it's striking, there are studies that look at the evolution of human language, and there's actually a paper published in Science, the student, I understand, that all human language are derived from a single original language. Again in Africa, again at this time. So there's actually independent evidence that suggests that all human languages are derived from a single primitive language, that a small population. You can imagine, again, that, so you go, how does a language get invented? See, so one of the things you have to ask me is, how does a language get invented? Now, I don't know if you've heard of the Nicaraguan sign language. So there was a school down in Nicaragua where they put together, basically it was a brand new school, and they put together a group of individuals who could not speak and who could not hear. And the teachers who were speaking tried to teach them American Sign Language. But what ended up happening is these kids, over the course of several months, basically invented an entire language that they isolated, they couldn't do anything. You put them together, and just the very nature of community and communication, they invented a brand new language that no one else outside that group could understand. And so I'm imagining something similar to that, where you have the appearance of a population of individuals, very small population of individuals that have the capacity for language, then you put them together with each other, and in time they start inventing a language. And when they have invented a language, it's now, unfortunately, it isolates them from everyone else. So there will tend to be more breeding now within that group, but that group is going to have much more of an advantage over the non-speaking relatives for the reasons that language can, we can transmit knowledge with language in a way that would be very difficult without. And so we're able to basically write encyclopedias. Yes?
I have a comment. It's very good that I mentioned, I think. What I want to say is we have lost opportunities and challenges in this area, in terms of science and because science now is progress very fast in the last
100 years.
Yeah, like if you talk about modern science, just 800 years of modern science from almost scratch, experimental, empiric, computer, but that's a that continued throughout to more. It's almost our understanding is much, much beyond our imagination, and also it is described in the Bible. For example, we know the universe has is about 14 billion years.
15 more, yeah.
And the Earth is about 4.5 billion years. But I mean, the universe is much, much longer than the Earth, which means there is possible, there's the other similar to Earth or writing the world than after before Earth. So in that sense, the life or human might actually originate not from Earth, from the planet, and then immigrate to.
Oh no, I mean, so you know that lander that landed on that comet is supposed to try to test the panspermia hypothesis, the idea that life evolved somewhere else was actually seeded in our planet. Now, you raise a very interesting thing. So when I speak with evangelical population audiences, you know, there is the added difficulty of reading the scriptures. So I was at a talk again, and I was giving this a similar talk at a group where there were a lot of evangelical Protestants, and they were like, well, one of the difficulties that evangelical Christianity has is that its account of how to read the Bible is much more difficult to reconcile with this data that I'm putting up here, okay? So, I have close friends who are evangelical Christians, and they'll say, you know, if we want to go there, so when I tell they want to go where this model, but one of the difficulties, there are two difficulties that they have, one theological and one involving biblical hermeneutics. So theologically, if you come from the Protestant tradition, if you go to Luther and Calvin, one of the things that you have there is a theological account of the utter depravity of the human being after sin. And part of the difficulty of that is that you have that theological account. Reason becomes so wounded that reason itself is unable to penetrate truth. And so when you don't think that reason is strong enough to discern truth, the only thing you have is faith. You know, and I remember here when I was here at MIT, I had a friend in the evangelical community. He was working as a mechanical engineer, course two. And he was saying, you know, we're talking about the fossils. And he said, well, the fossils were placed to the ground by the devil to test your faith. Now he's coming from a particular tradition in Christianity that sees faith as the primary virtue intellectually for the human being, certainly for the believer. So this is a particular struggle, right? So he goes, and so you're trying to show how faith, now I'm trying to show him that once he opens himself up to that, there are problems with science. Because I say, when I do my experiments, I'm assuming that there's not a little demon running around who's going to change the kill curve in one of my test tubes as compared to the next test tube. Otherwise, my p-values will be all over the roof. So we assume a certain regularity in creation, and we do not think that demons go in there and regularly change that. Having said that, demons are real, but that's a different story, right? They do things that can mess things up, but they're not worried about scientific experiments. So when you deal with this, you have to come up with, how do you change a theological account of reason? Because now what happens is, you have to trust that reason can read the Bible in a way that reveals truth. And from the Catholic tradition, this is not a problem. You go all the way back to Augustine, 410 AD, and you begin to see that he's able to interpret scripture, accounting for the fact that there are different modes in which scripture is written. So I'll give you an example, right? A love letter. You see a love letter. Now, you will read the love letter differently, right? Say you get a love letter. Alright? You get a love letter. you are going to read that letter differently than your roommate reading that same letter. You are going to see meaning, you're going to see symbolism, you're going to see ritual that you have, that you are able to see because your beloved and you have been hanging out, you know, in the Athena cluster for 5 months. And you just know her, and she knows you. And she will use little coded words, and you will know that. There'll be inside jokes. And your roommate will have no clue about this. The Bible is full of inside jokes. It is written by believers for believers. So if you are not aware of the inside jokes, and if you read them as someone who reads them at face value, you can be prone to confusion. So what reason has to do is we need to figure out the inside joke so we can understand what was going on. So if you look, for example, at the first creation account, if you look at the first creation account called the Hexameron, so that's 6 days. I know there's 7 days, but God worked in 6 days and then he hung out and rested on the seventh. Now, if you look at the Hexameron, and if you figure out why did the author, the sacred author, write the Hexameron in that way, if you figure out, you will discover that he wrote it while the chosen people were in Babylon in exile. They were surrounded by these Babylonian non-believers who believed that the sun was a god, the moon was a god. And so what does the Jewish author says? He says, look, I'm going to write a story to tell you that these so-called gods are not God. And so what does he do? He writes a narrative and he says, in the beginning. And you notice there wasn't a sun. There wasn't a moon. And it was important for him to say there was not a sun, there was not a moon, because he wanted to tell the people who were living in exile that all these pagan gods that you see around you, they are actually creatures of the one true God. And that's why they're in the order that they have, because this is the hierarchy of gods that the Babylonians have. Now you see, if you didn't know this, if you did not know that the inside joke was that you were having a conversation between Jewish believers and other Jewish believers surrounded by pagans in Babylon, and we're having a joke. You see this sun god? Ha! We know it's not a god because God made it. You see? And you needed to know that. Now, if you didn't know that, you would think that he wrote it as a historical account, like a New York Times reporter. I doubt that. I don't think New York Times reporters write historical accounts now. They want to make news, not just simply report news. I think that's the problem with the 24-cycle media, unfortunately. But you get to the point where, at the end of the day, right, at the end of the day, you need to understand the love letter. And reason allows you to understand that love letter. And so we know from scriptural studies, anthropological studies, we know that the Bible was written, and the first 11 chapters of Genesis were written in a particular way to convey a particular message. And one of those messages was not to talk about the science, the scientific architecture of creation. The most important thing those two narratives wanted to say was to say, God created everything. So see, once you get there, but my friends who are evangelicals, they have difficulties with that because of theological concerns. As they point out, they'll say, well, if you say, that Genesis is to be taken not literalistically, right? Now there's a difference between literalistically and literally. So you have to take it for what it says, but how it was meant to be taken by the author. If you take it that way, how do you know that you can't take something else, say the resurrection, as a figurative metaphor? And I say, well, different love letters are written in different ages, and you figure out which love letter was written to whom, and who, and what was it written for. And if you look at the Gospel of John was saying, look, I'm writing to tell you what I actually saw. Now, we can also do a lot of scripture studies to figure out what are the influences and the concerns, what was the inside joke at the time. But one of the things you get is he really wanted to talk about this incredible historical event which he couldn't explain. This dude rose from the dead. And this dude who rose from the dead was so amazing and incredible that my life is forever changed and I will face death in a way I couldn't imagine before. That's the Christian gospel. This incredible dude, this carpenter from like boondocks, Nazareth, from the middle of nowhere. It's like saying, oh, this guy from Lewiston, Kansas. Okay, I apologize for anyone from Kansas, but you know, but is now the savior of the world. I'm like, you guys would be nuts. But that's what the gospel is trying to say. You see? And so now as a Catholic Christian, you have a tradition, you have a theological, epistemological claim about how we discern what is true, what is false, and how we know what's authentic and what's not an authentic interpretation. Unfortunately, because of the Reformation, some of our brothers and sisters from these Reformed traditions don't have that. That was part of the stuff that they thought they had to throw out. And that's why there's a problem. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
So, last year I went to a really interesting talk on evolution of behaviors, in particular, very human behavior like self sacrifice, offense. And it was very interesting because the presenter clearly showed some demonstrations among bacterial colonies, among chimpanzees, where fairness and self sacrifice are evident as well. From a theological perspective, what, how do you make of all that? Like?
Okay, so. So there is, so for example, Bacillus subtilis, which is an incredible unicellular organism that is studied over up at Harvard, will commit suicide and spill its guts out to feed its neighbor. Right? Now its neighbor has to be genetically related to itself. You understand? So one of the things that you discover with altruistic programs of behavior in modern biology is somewhere along the way, you have to have genetic, you have to share some genetic, you have to share some of the genes with the creature that you are going to try to help out, because otherwise we cannot explain why you would surrender your genes for the genes of that creature. Christianity would say, and this of course is the supernatural part, right, is that Mother Teresa was able to help those who were outside her particular tribal structure. And so this is an alpha. Now there are attempts to try to explain this. So the idea is that if I help the homeless guy down on Boylston Street, you will see me help the guy, and because you see me, and you will help me, and therefore I'll have more kids. Okay, so it's a very simplistic way of trying to explain some accounts of altruism. One of the basic principles in Catholic theology, especially in theology, the theological tradition that I work in, which is the Dominican tradition, is that grace builds on nature. Because nature comes from God, so it's not like one comes from the other, right? So people have asked me, like, how do you know you're a Dominican, right? And why did you choose the Dominican, not the Jesuits, for example, or the Franciscans? And I say, one of the things I discovered here at MIT through the help of the Catholic Fellowship and my friends, and it's striking, you know, I entered the Dominican Order, and then two other guys from our group entered the Dominican Order, and then one of our women friends is a Dominican nun in the Dominican Order. I mean, there was a time all of a sudden this group of Catholic Fellowship within the TCC was like generating like religious vocations, priests, or secular diocesan priests from that group, and then we have lots of married couples with lots of kids, and of course we've gone and baptized them, and blah, 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 blah. So it's one of the great joys of this. But if grace builds on nature, then all of this stuff, all this biology can be true, right? And God works with that, because that's what God actually, he works with that, and then he elevates that with grace. So that there are some of us who naturally are nice. You understand? There are some of us who are just naturally nice. But nice is not good enough for a Christian. Because you are called to love, especially when you don't necessarily like people. So, I mean, I tell people, I don't necessarily have to like everybody, but I have to love them. And so, and there's a difference. And so that niceness, you can now build on that niceness, and that niceness can become self-sacrificing charity. Now, there are some people who are just not nice naturally. Everything is grace. I mean, you know these people. I mean, it is grace. You see? It is grace. God, and usually what happens, you can see this. I have had a great privilege. You see someone who is just not nice. And then there's a Dominican priest. He's actually, his cause is up. You know, so he's being considered to be canonized as a saint. And the people he lived with said, I don't believe it. He was so nasty when he was young. Now, it turned out this is what happened. So when he was young, he lived out in California. And then he was sent as a missionary out to the Philippines. And in the Philippines, he basically spent 40 years of his, the last 40 years of his life living in a leper colony. And living in a leper colony and setting up a leprosarium, as well as just helping this community. If you go there now and speak to the people who remembered him, you know that this man, who is the father of this leper colony, that brought great joy to hundreds, if not thousands, of lepers, and to help them heal, that man is the same man who absolutely annoyed and ticked off all the other Dominicans he had to live with when he was back in Los Angeles. Or when he was back in San Francisco. Nature, grace can do so much to nature. And that's why the saints are there, to show us that, you know, we become holy. It's not because of who we are, but because of who God is. And it is God who takes and transforms us and makes us into the kind of saints that. And the problem is, we spend most of our time getting in the way. We just get in his way, and he wants to do this, and we get in the way. We have our own projects to do. We think we know how to make ourselves happy, and the difficulty is sometimes, often, we end up getting into trouble. And part, I think, of the Christian gospel is coming to terms with that frailty that is within us, and discovering that the gospel of Jesus Christ offers us. It's an invitation. Not all will take it. You know, I am a chaplain at Brown University, in addition to my responsibilities as a professor at Providence College, and so many questions come up, especially if this is the month of November. In the month of November, Catholics are asked to think about death and dying and judgment. And one of my sophomores, who is a computer science major, was just talking to me last week and said, I have friends who just don't, I just don't think, are they going to go to hell? You know, and like, they're not religious, they're not, and I go, that's a great mystery, but this is what, and I've explained to him, right, and it's a great mystery, that we are free to choose however we wish to live our lives, and the Christian gospel, I mean, Christians are arrogant enough, see, we're arrogant, and that drives some people crazy, that Christians are arrogant enough to say that Christians can tell you how to live a better life than you are living now. That's incredibly arrogant. And that's why Christians have to be deeply humble. And God has to humble us in order for us to make that message convincing. Because if you are a jerk, no one is going to listen to you. But if you are someone who is broken, who is wounded, who has experienced God's mercy, who has experienced God's grace, who's able to speak from weakness, who's able to speak about strength from a position of, who can speak about God without focusing yourself, you become someone who is able, because very few people can do that, who can give a word of hope. See? So that's how it works. That's how the great mystery of faith is. And it's a mystery I am still trying to grapple with, you know? When I entered the Dominican Order, I had to study philosophy, and I said, why am I studying philosophy? I'm a molecular biologist. Like, What does philosophy have to tell me? It took my brothers 2 years plus to convince me that philosophy, which is the interrogation and the investigation of what is intelligible, right, could complement science, which is the study of what is sensible. You see, so you were saying how science is empirical in these experiments. It's all about the sensible. We forget, too, that especially if you're a theoretical physicist, it is about the intelligible. But philosophy and theology is primarily about the intelligible. And you have to bring both together in order to be a coherent human being. Any other questions?
I think that perhaps.
Thank you so much for your kind attention.